Hello and welcome to State View, a program that looks at various state topics and how they impact you here living in the city. Joining me today to talk about the fiscal year 20 state budget is State Senator John Keenan. John, welcome back.
Great, thanks to be here. Hey, I like your tie.
Yeah, well, I have one exactly the same as you. What are the chances? You know, yeah. With all the, it's funny though, with all the different ties out there, it's rare to find somebody that has the same tie as you.
It's very rare. Although it's becoming increasingly more common because it's tough to find ties places. So people are buying the same ties.
Well, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Today we will look at the budget. Let's go through the budget process. And of course, the Senate has finalized the budget. So you have finalized the budget. But talk about that and also the House and, of course, the governor's budget.
Sure.
There's three involved.
Yeah, so the budget process actually starts, the fiscal year goes from July 1st to June 30th. So on July 1st, essentially, the governor's team is at work putting together the governor's budget. So they work throughout the summer months and into the fall, dealing with the agencies, talking to the agency heads, getting a sense of what they need in the various departments. And then the governor uses it as well to set priorities for the upcoming fiscal year. They work on that, and then there's hearings to determine what the revenue picture will look like for the upcoming fiscal year. Those hearings are done usually in December or early January. Then there's a consensus revenue figure determined, meaning the House, the Senate, and the governor all come to agreement on what revenues they will have to use. And then the governor files his budget. The House and Senate take a look at that budget to determine what the governor's priorities were. And meanwhile, the House was working on its budget and the Senate on its own budget. So the House then introduced its budget in April. They open it up for amendments. They debate those amendments in the budget. They pass their budget. In May, the Senate files its budget. There's amendments, there's floor debate, and it passes its own budget. So at this stage, the governor's budget has been reviewed and set aside. The House has hit its budget. Senate has its own budget. And where those two are different, they are reconciled through what they call a conference committee. And that's the stage we're at now. The House has approved its budget. The Senate's done its own budget. So there's six individuals now, three from the Senate, three from the House, that are meeting to determine what the final budget that will be presented to the governor looks like. The goal is to get that to the governor by the end of June. The governor then can veto the budget, veto sections. And again, the goal is to have the budget in place for July 1st.
And we will have to naturally have you back at that point and talk more about the finalized budget. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the current fiscal picture.
The current fiscal picture is better than it has been over the last few years. The state right now is on a path that it will have a surplus, much of which will go into our stabilization fund. Our stabilization fund has peaked somewhere about $3 billion in the past, $3 billion on a much lower budget. Our budget is higher now 11 years later than it was when things kind of collapsed in 2008 and we had to start to use our stabilization fund. But our stabilization fund isn't quite up to where it was or where it should be.
Which was known as the rainy day fund.
Rainy day fund, yeah. So if it rains, if bad news comes with rain, that we have some funds to kind of ease the cuts that would otherwise occur. So we have to continue to increase that, and there will be money from this year's surplus that will go into the rainy day fund, the stabilization account.
Stabilization fund now exceeds $2 billion.
Yes. And at its peak, it was higher than that. And some estimates are there should be as high as $5 billion, given the size of our state budget presently. So we have a lot of work to do to get to that number.
We should mention that numbers for unemployment are at record lows.
Yes, thankfully.
Which, of course, all plays into this.
Right. The unemployment numbers are very good. We're hearing in some sectors of the economy that employees are actually having difficulty finding qualified employees. And so the state's trying to respond with doing some targeted workforce training through workforce training groups, through our community colleges, trying to get them to be nimble and to offer different programs that people can then go into and move right into employment after that. So we're trying to do that. There's always a concern about what's going to happen with the economy at the federal level. They're predicting a downturn perhaps late in 2020. And so you've got to be ready for that. Massachusetts' economy is fairly broad-based, but nonetheless, we're not immune to another downturn. And so we can't go crazy spending revenues. We've got to make sure, again, we do our stabilization account and that we build sustainability into our budget.
I think you would agree that the markets are doing well right now, but there's a lot of talk about tariffs, and that could affect the economy.
Yes, and tariffs affect the economy in very different ways, sometimes ways that you don't anticipate. Most of the products that we use now have products within them from, or materials within them from many countries. So even though there may be a tariff on China, and we think, well, China isn't a big supplier of good X, well, many components of good X may come from China, and so indirectly impacts the price of that good as it comes to the United States. The same with Mexico. Cars have parts that are made from all over the world. It's just a question of where they're assembled and the final product is produced. So tariffs aren't as simple as sometimes conveyed. There's a sense that, oh, it's going to bring money into our coffers, the federal coffers, but really that's money that's being paid for by consumers. It's being passed on. So you have to be very careful. And with the projections of the economy turning perhaps in 2020 without tariffs, with tariffs, there should be some concern that it will accelerate that process. And in Massachusetts, our economy is broad-based, but that means also that so many of the things that we do here are impacted by tariffs, whether they be in China, whether they be on Mexico, wherever the Washington may impose them.
Well, and I've heard talk about possibly Japan and European countries as well.
Yeah, and that's just about every good that we consume will be impacted by a tariff. China is obviously responding with tariffs of their own, so goods that we sell or export from the United States will be impacted. The cranberry industry, for instance, which is near and dear to our hearts here in Massachusetts, that's impacted by tariffs. They were looking to Asia to expand their markets, and now that's being impacted. So, you know how they say all politics is local? All tariffs end up having a local impact as well. And so as a state government, we've got to be cognizant of that and make sure that we plan accordingly.
We do have a pie chart that will be on screen momentarily. It deals with expenditures.
Yes, as you look at the pie chart, you'll notice the green area, the bottom right, that's 44% of our budget, that's healthcare. That is our MassHealth. It is our various connected programs. It's also our employee health insurance for state employees. 44% is a significant number. Much of what's driving that 44% presently is the cost of medications. And so there's some initiatives to try to bring those costs under control. The governor has proposed a plan. The Senate plan is fairly close to the governor's. The House has a somewhat different approach, but that's something that will be worked out in conference committee. At least there's agreement between the governor, the House, and the Senate that something has to be done about it. And I'm confident that we will do something about it to bring down the prices, or at least stabilize the prices of medications.
Let's look at some other areas on that chart. If we could bring that back onto the screen. Education, 18%.
Yes, education is an area where I think there's general agreement as well that there needs to be investment. And we have increased education funding in Quincy, for instance, under Chapter 70, which is kind of the general education funding for the city. That will increase $1.25 million this year over last year. And that's money that helps the school meet its per pupil expenditures and many of the other things that they have there. Healthcare costs for their employees. Education is always a priority at the state level. Unfortunately, we just are never able to commit the resources that I think everybody believes we should. One of the things that we face at the state level is revenues. And people always think that, oh, their state taxes are going up, their state taxes are going up. Well, the last several years, the state tax rate has gone down. And that has had an impact on our budget, and it has impacted our ability to invest what we'd like to invest in education, in transportation, in housing. It's had an impact. And there is the debate still about whether the state will come up with a new taxation program to better reflect today's economy compared to the economy of 40 or 50 years ago when our present tax scheme was put in place, even longer than that.
See if we could get on the screen just in a moment or so the following slide, which would be the education spending, and it has a couple of bullet points that we will address. I believe you addressed the first one, but let's talk about this slide if we could.
Sure. So we look at back when there was education reform, there was a formula that was put in place. And that formula determines, you know, what is the appropriate amount to spend per pupil within each city or town in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And there has always been the goal to fully fund the foundation budget. There has been a Foundation Budget Review Commission that has met over the years, that made recommendations. They've called for additional spending to modernize the spending or to update the spending on education. And so each year there's an effort to do that. And you'll notice here that the minimum aid increase was at least $30 per pupil over FY 2019, and as well as 100% effort reduction to bring all school districts to their target local contribution. There's education is funded with local tax dollars and with state tax dollars. And so you try to find the resources at each level to make sure that there's the right amount being spent. And I think most educators, most people in government would tell you that we haven't quite gotten to that level yet, although it is a goal and we are incrementally getting there. And the other part of that issue is updating the formula, and how do you update that formula so that it impacts each of the communities fairly, so that one community doesn't see a dramatic increase at the expense of another. So there's going to be kind of a hold harmless and then an adjustment of the formula going forward. And that's a difficult task.
And how about special education?
Special education is one that's always difficult to budget for. I remember when I was in local government here in Quincy in the mayor's office doing budget work, and then in the city council as a finance chair, and working with the school department, that was always a number you just didn't know. Because a student could come into your community from another district and come in with their education plan that you then must fund. And if that education plan is perhaps an out-of-district placement, the tuition can be tens of thousands of dollars per year. And then when you put the educational, the transportation cost into that, you're talking of a magnitude sometimes of $100,000, $100,000+ per year per pupil for special education. So we hear constantly from local government, is there a way to better fund that? And recently I had conversations with superintendents, and you know, there's been some suggestion that maybe the state take over the funding of that, remove the obligation from the cities and towns, and remove some of the funding that's going to cities and towns for it now, and then the towns and the cities would have a more predictable education budget, and the unpredictability of it would be addressed at the state level. So if a person moved from Braintree to Quincy to Framingham, the state would handle that rather than Braintree, Quincy, and Framingham. And I think there's some logic to that, and whether we get there or not, who knows. Sometimes logic and government are a little bit at odds, especially in Washington.
Yes. Let's look at local aid.
Yeah, local aid, part of it is education, and the other part of it is unrestricted general government aid that we provide. In Quincy this year, it will go up $533,000, and that's about what the governor, the House, and the Senate have agreed on. And that's used to fund libraries. It's used to fund senior centers. It's used to fund police, fire. It's money that's given to the municipality, and then they use it in the course of their part of their regular budgeting to make sure that essential city services are funded and delivered. And that's the money that's used for that.
And if we bring that screen up just for one more moment, if we could. Libraries, $11.5 million for regional library local aid.
Yeah, the libraries do a great job of coordinating for the sharing of materials, the sharing of technology. And so we try to recognize that each year and work with the various library groups, the regional groups, the library commissioners, and try to balance out where the funds should go each year. I personally believe that libraries have been underfunded. They do incredible work. We're fortunate here in the city of Quincy because local government picks up a substantial part of the library funding, most of it. And so our library is well funded and is open a lot of hours, and it's just a great place, particularly our main branch, but our neighborhood branches as well. Other towns don't have, aren't as fortunate. In some of the towns in my district, the library hours are somewhat limited, and there's less access as a result, less access to materials. And so we try to get as much funding to the libraries as possible through these specific targeted library funding programs. They always have a need for technology. They have a need for the physical sharing of materials, even though they do it very cost effectively. you can go online and get a book delivered to the Quinn Thomas Crane Library from Marshfield or something, and essentially have it the next day.
I do it all the time, yeah. So I know exactly what that's like.
And they do a really good job with it.
Talk about senior centers and 18.1 million for local council on aging. And in that, also talk about the importance of when you do visit a senior center to register that you've been there.
Correct. All the senior centers now, when you go in, there's a screen, a computer screen, that they ask you to basically touch and log in so that you're counted for the day. Those numbers are used in when the formula for the distribution of aid to the community centers, to the Council on Aging, is determined. So obviously the Council on Aging, instead of getting greater use, will get greater funding. So it's very important, whether you go to the Kennedy Center here in Quincy or whether you go to the Nyman Center in Rockland or any of the local senior centers, that you do check in, because then that means that the resources are fairly allocated. It's essential funding. The senior centers are so widely used, offering so many incredible programs. It's some of the best money that we spend, I believe. I can just give you a quick example. The Kennedy Center is always crowded. You go to the Kennedy Center in Quincy, there's always an event going on. It's great to catch up with people. They'll be doing Tai Chi in one room. They'll be doing art in one room. They'll be playing instruments in another room. There'll be a luncheon at noontime. And in Rockland, they had an old senior center. They had a room in an old school. And they raised the funds through an override to money specifically for the Council on Aging to build a new Council on Aging. And it's a beautiful facility, four times at least bigger than what they had. And it's not big enough. People flock there. It's tough to find parking there. And it's a place where people go, and the minute they walk through the door, people know their name, they welcome them. There's different groups. It's a lot of socializing. So it's really, really an important part of what we do with making sure those centers are funded properly.
We do have, or will have, a chart on screen momentarily. It really depicts local aid for Quincy specifically.
Yeah, so these are the numbers that I kind of touched on, and it gives you a little bit of where we were last year. So last year in Chapter 70, we were at about $27.4 million, and then the governor made his proposal about 28.5. The House came in at about 28.6, and then we came in essentially at the same number as the House. The good news on that is, because the numbers are pretty much the exact same, that that won't get stuck in conference. There won't be a lot of debate about that among the six people who are finalizing the state budget. So those are the numbers that essentially should come out. And then the unrestricted general government aid that we talked about, you can see that it went from about $19.74 million last year up to about $20.2 million this year. And again, that's money that the city uses to fund its general operations.
Let's look now, if we could, at some highlights specifically to Quincy.
Sure. We had the different slide that came up. So we do every year that we try to get into the state budget some money for our hazardous materials unit within the fire department. So we coordinate with the House of Representatives, and you know, we'd like to see it automatically put in the budget each year, but we have to do it through the budget amendment process. So file an amendment, it's voted on, and generally the House does the same thing, so we are pretty comfortable knowing that that money will be in the final budget that's sent to the governor. And that's money that the fire department uses for hazardous materials training. They have really taken a leadership role in that in the South Shore, and they do a phenomenal job. And that money, it's not a lot of money, but it's really pretty important for them. The other one that we focused on the last couple of years is funding over at the Adams Crypt at the Church of Presidents. We have put money in the budget through the Senate, through amendments that I have filed, to move towards making sure that that building is sprinkled. When you think that there are two presidents and their wives in the basement of that church, buried in the basement of that church, and it's not sprinkled. The first thought I had when I saw the fire over in France at Notre Dame was that could be our Church of Presidents. You know, very historical here, different size buildings and
right.
All that, but incredibly historically significant.
Correct.
And if anything happened there, it would be a tragedy. So we've been working on that the last couple of years, and the fire at Notre Dame really hit home. And when that hit, I know that people over who run the programs over at the church had the same response, and we've got to continue this process. So we have money in the budget for that. And the other one that we have is the Manatt Community Health Center. Manatt does incredible work, as does South Cove Community Health Center here in Quincy. We're very fortunate to have both of them. Manit is looking to do a couple things. One is to integrate behavioral and medical health, and then also to look at providing urgent care. So we were able in the Senate budget to get money allocated to move those programs forward. And hopefully it will come out of conference committee in the final budget that will be sent to the governor. They're really critical programs. Manit serves a population that otherwise wouldn't have access. And it's interesting, people think of Manit just in that context in South Cove, but Manit is a community health center that provides health care to everybody. You have insurance, you're welcome. You're covered by MassHealth, you're welcome. Their physicians and nurse practitioners and all their practitioners there a top rate, and so they really do a phenomenal job, and this money will help them continue to move forward to meet the area's needs.
Let's look, if we can, at child care and securing some money for that.
Yes, so we every year the child care advocates come to the State House and ask us to support increased funding. And I would venture to say that every member of our legislative delegation in Quincy, Leader Mariano, Representatives Chan, Ayers, and Hunt, myself, they don't have to ask. We know how important it is, and we know the important services that they provide to families here. The challenge in that is always the appropriate rate to pay those who provide the care to make sure that they can survive. The teachers, the programming itself survives. So every year we try to increase the rate and the funding for early childhood education, whether it be through programs offered by QCAP, through the YMCA, the STARS program we have here, all the different providers. They're part of the fabric of our community, and the role that they play in nurturing and educating our young is really, really critically important.
I do need to bring up the opioid crisis, because it certainly is a crisis. And how does the budget, the Senate budget, reflect monies going to that?
We're putting some money in reserve. We're continuing to fund, put in place some funding for additional beds, additional programming, for bulk purchasing of naloxone, otherwise known as Narcan. So there's a whole host of programs that we continue to fund and to continue to advance. There's a change occurring in how opioid addiction is being treated. There's a recognition that we'll never have enough beds to treat everybody in what has been, I guess, the traditional way. You go to detox and step down. And so there's a movement towards medication-assisted treatment, which is considered now a best practice and is the best way to treat people who are struggling with addiction. So we continue to fund those types of programs as well. And there's also State Senator Julian Sear on the Cape. He filed an amendment that would allow for some harm reduction, which would include test strips to determine whether there's fentanyl present in drugs, so that people know, not to use something, or if they are addicted and use it because they're addicted, that at least they know what's in the drug and can modify their behavior accordingly, not use as much or whatever the case may be. Also for Narcan, for education. So there's a lot that was in that kind of the harm reduction amendment that passed in the Senate and will hopefully pass in the House as well.
And you and I just spoke prior to the show about lifeguard training and how that has changed a bit as well.
Yes, lifeguards are being trained to administer Narcan because overdoses are occurring everywhere.
I do want to talk about the e-cigarette tax.
Yes.
And we did, and folks will see at length, a program about tobacco-related legislation. But let's touch upon this because this does come in the form of the proposed budget.
Sure. So the governor introduced it in his budget. The House, if I remember correctly, did not do anything on the tax in its budget, and the Senate then did have the excise tax in its budget on tobacco products. And that would include specifically e-cigarettes and flavorings and things related to e-cigarettes. Historically, a tax on tobacco products has not only generated revenue that's then used for education and cessation programs, but it has also shown historically that it curbs use, that use declines. And so the hope is that by putting the tax on e-cigarettes, which are not taxed, that will curb the use of e-cigarettes. Now, some say, why do we want to do that? Because e-cigarettes are better than regular cigarettes. For a segment of the population, some are transferring from combustible regular cigarettes to e-cigarettes and feel that there's an advantage. But for every adult that makes that switch or starts using e-cigarettes, six times as many young people are now using e-cigarettes, and they would never have smoked cigarettes previously. So the tax will have an impact. We think it will have less of an impact than it has historically, and so filed legislation to ban tobacco-flavored products. There's 8,000 flavored products out there for young people to use when they're vaping or using e-cigarettes. And so we think the tax is important, banning the flavors is an essential component, and then cessation programs for those thousands of kids who are already severely addicted. It has to be a holistic approach, and those are the three legs of the stool that we're looking at to address the vaping issue.
While we're talking about addictive substances, I do want to talk a bit about safe injection sites and talk about a visit that you made recently.
Sure. Just last weekend, I got my car and went up to Montreal on my own and observed safe injection sites. There was a commission that looked at that here in Massachusetts. And the commission essentially said that there's a role for them in addressing the opioid epidemic. One of the issues is that it's not permitted under federal law. But nonetheless, I thought it was important to get a firsthand look at safe injection sites and to talk with people who have been involved with them before we proceed any further. This was my own, I did this, as I said, my own curiosity. So I drove up to Montreal and I spent Saturday night standing in a doorway across the street from one of these facilities, sitting on a bench right outside, kind of observing the comings and goings at the facility. I did the same thing on a Sunday night, about 11 o'clock, 11:30 at night, just kind of hanging around watching. And then on Monday, I spent the day with public health and law enforcement officials and program administrators in Montreal who provide these services. It's really interesting, and it's kind of counterintuitive. People think that to provide these services would be to enable people or encourage people to continue with their drug use. But a couple things. One, there are bathrooms and gas stations and elsewhere here in Quincy, for instance, that have signs on the wall saying, if you overdose, don't be afraid to call 911. So we know that people are injecting in bathrooms. And we know that they are exchanging needles at various locations in the greater Boston area. And so the response that Canada has had, Montreal in particular, has been, we know that's going on. They're going around the corner and injecting in a schoolyard or a park. Wouldn't it be better to have them inject in a supervised facility where there's a nurse and clinical people to assist them rather than out in the streets? We know that they'll have clean needles, which will slow down the spread of HIV and hepatitis C and different diseases related to infections and abscesses. And we move needles from the parks, and it's an approach. And law enforcement told me directly they've noticed no difference. It's the same people that are using these drugs. Now they're using them in a supervised facility, and they are safer, and there's been no impact in crime or anything else. And in fact, they think it's lessened street use of the drugs.
I want to thank you for stopping by. There was one more question. We'll have to save it for the next show. It was on texting and phone use in cars. So we'll talk about that.
Sure, absolutely.
The next time you come in. But thank you for stopping
by. Thank you.
And we will see you hopefully in short order.
Great.
We'll be back at QA TV.
Always great to be here. Thank you.
Pleasure. Thanks. And thank you at home for watching. You have been watching a program of Quincy Access Television. Please continue to watch QA TV for more locally produced programming.